Coffee Conversations with Scientists, where each month we bring you the science behind the topics you're hearing about in the news. The series is brought to you by the Advancing a Healthier Wisconsin Endowment, a statewide nonprofit that is working to improve health and improve health equity in Wisconsin. I am Dr. Jesse Ehrenfeld, director of the endowment and your host today. And I am just thrilled to be here to talk about this because I join you not only as a doctor who cares deeply about bringing you the best and latest scientific information, but I'm also the parent of a two-year-old toddler who shares your concerns for your kids. So today we are joined by Dr. Michael Gutzeit, Chief Medical Officer for Children's Wisconsin, who's going to give us an update about what we know about kids and COVID, vaccine safety, and the best guidance he can give us for keeping all of our families safe and healthy. Dr. Gutzeit, welcome to Coffee Conversations.
Good morning, Dr. Ehrenfeld, and thank you for inviting me, and hello to the all those in the audience today. It's a real pleasure to be here. An exciting time, as we were talking about just before the start, there's been some exciting and welcome developments that we're going to talk about, I know.
Well, this couldn't be more timely. I bet your phone is ringing off the hook with everything that's going on at the FDA and everything in the news. So thank you so much for being here. Really, really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Yeah, it is an exciting time. And so I'm happy to have the conversation and hopefully answer some great questions that people are asking about this.
Absolutely. So while Dr. Gutzeit and I will cover a list of questions that we're hearing and we've compiled from parents and other caregivers like you all, I want to encourage everyone who's watching to drop your questions you have into the comments. We'll be getting to as many of those as possible in just a little bit. So let's go ahead and kind of dive right in. So Dr. Gutzeit, let me start by asking you to describe the current state of COVID in Wisconsin. What are you seeing in terms of cases among kids, the impact of COVID, how serious is it, what's going on?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ehrenfeld, for that lead-in question. I think it's a great one. And I think it's important to pause and just remember, we've been in a COVID environment for nearly 2 years now, and it has had a profound impact on all of us professionally, personally, socially. And it has been a very, very trying experience for so many of us. And so I am grateful for people who want to learn more about COVID, and COVID continues to be something that we learn more and more about. We have to remember, it's a virus that we've only known about for just about 2 years. And so we're continuing to learn more about that, more about vaccines. And so having these types of sessions is wonderful because it gives us all a chance to look to trusted resources, share information about what we know and what we don't know. Specifically in Wisconsin, many of you know that the Delta variant of COVID, of the virus causing COVID, has been present for a few months now and caused a tremendous surge over the past few months. And that also affected kids. While I would say that the impact of COVID has been felt most acutely in adult patients, kids are not immune to this, and it is not a benign or harmless infection in kids. And in the state of Wisconsin, we saw a tremendous surge in kids having COVID caused by the Delta variant over the course of the past few months. Now, thankfully, we started to see a little bit of a decline in terms of the number of cases of COVID and the number of those that are infected. And what we've seen in kids is about 20 to 21% of the new cases are in those who are under 18 years of age. So we continue to monitor and watch that closely.
Are kids spreading it in school? I know there's a lot of concern about the school year starting up, kids back in school. What is that looking like?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because I think that there has been a variability in terms of what we've seen because the prevalence of infection has been so high in the state, the prevalence of infection in kids is much higher. One thing that we do know is that when mitigation strategies are put in place, and we'll talk about this a little bit more, and by mitigation, I mean layers of protection, things like washing hands, wearing masks, getting vaccinated when possible, watching distance, that makes a difference. And we do see that in schools, when those mitigation layers and strategies are put in place, it does decrease the spread.
All right, so let's turn to vaccines. Over the past year, vaccines have been tested, approved for children 12 and older. And just yesterday, the FDA met to begin the process of reviewing data on the safety and effectiveness for COVID vaccines for children 5 to 12. This is an important step in the vaccines being authorized for that group. What can you tell us? What's the FDA looking at?
Yeah, let's talk about the process a little bit. And just a quick backstory here. You know, it is amazing that we have the availability of vaccine that we do in this country. We are very fortunate. I am grateful that we have the availability of that vaccine currently for those who are, in the age range that it's available for. So 12 and up. And that's very, very exciting. The thing that is really interesting is that we're still learning about the vaccine too. And this development is really exciting and very welcome. So what happened, and I'll talk through the process just a little bit because it can be confusing. There are a number of steps, and rightly so, before a vaccine is given emergency use authorization or full approval. And that is designed to put in place checks and balances so that there's scrutiny about the vaccine, the side effects of the vaccine, and the risks and benefits of the vaccine. So Dr. Ehrenfeld, specifically what happens is that yesterday, an advisory committee of the Food and Drug Administration, the FDA, recommended emergency use authorization for 5 to 11 year olds for the Pfizer vaccine, the Pfizer COVID vaccine. So that has been recommended to the full FDA. Now, the full FDA panel will take that up probably this week, within the next couple of days, and will determine whether they are going to accept that recommendation for emergency use authorization or modify it or not. So there'll be a step in the process where there'll be another group that will be looking at that. Now, once that happens, then the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC, will then take up the recommendation. And there's an advisory committee on immunization practices that will make recommendations about if there is agreement to proceed, what that would look like, what the dosing should look like, and how to roll that out. So there are, you know, I'm really excited as a pediatrician because we have the vaccine. It's close to being available to even more kids, but we have to go through the necessary steps and processes and checks and balances. So the best anticipation is the vaccine might be available sometime, maybe next week, but we'll wait to see.
Okay, so it sounds like a really important step, but still a couple of things left before shots in arms for five and up. What is the data from real world studies telling us though about these vaccines?
Yeah, very important question. And you're right, while we have excitement, we wanna make sure we go through the process, right? With that, there's a process in place for a reason, the checks and balances and weighing the risks and benefits. What we understand from the data that was submitted by Pfizer that was considered by the FDA panel is that the real world experience was in about 2,200 or 2,300 kids. Now, some may say, well, that doesn't seem like very many, but that's very consistent with how the initial emergency use authorization protocol was followed earlier on when the vaccines were first approved earlier this year. So it's very consistent. And as I want to stress again that we continue to learn about the vaccine more and more. The data that's been submitted so far looks to be enough to make a recommendation based upon the risks and benefits. And we'll talk about that in just a second. I think there'll be some questions about, you know, what are the risks to kids and why do we want to look at the vaccine versus the natural illness and things like that. But there's enough data to suggest that there's a much higher benefit to the vaccine than there is risk. And we will continue to learn as the vaccine becomes available, just as we've had that learning process over the last almost year now since the vaccines were first released.
So what are these data, you know, what the FDA is looking at, what the companies have been submitting, tell you about the safety and effectiveness of these vaccines thus far?
Yeah. Having looked at least the initial data, and there'll be more forthcoming as it's released, but at least looking at the initial data, it seems to be a very, very safe vaccine. And again, the benefits of the vaccine seem to outweigh the side effects of the vaccine. And we'll certainly talk about that too.
And so you sort of covered it, but I want to make sure we get there. So timeline, as best as you can see, leading to potential official approval of vaccines for kids five and up.
Yep. Right. And let's reiterate that because you're right. There are so many steps in this process, Dr. Ehrenfeld. Anticipation is that as early as next week, final approval for emergency use authorization. And then most importantly, then the vaccine has to be shipped to the sites that will be delivering vaccine, the primary care offices, things like that. So as soon as the approval is given, doesn't necessarily mean the vaccine will be immediately available because there's a shipping process, a receipt of that process. There'll need to be the other steps to make sure that it's able to be safely delivered and all the other things that go into the safe administration of vaccines.
So for parents who are eager and excited, they want to get their kids protected, what should they be doing right now? Should they call their doctor's office to make an appointment?
Yeah. Be enthusiastic and be patient. I think that one thing to do, there are several things that could be done to help to give better information about when the vaccine will be available. Certainly, one can follow the process as it's going through the FDA and CDC approvals and see when things move forward. And as I said, we're anticipating as early as next week an approval for emergency use authorization. I do think it would be very helpful for individuals to call their office or check out the Facebook for their primary care providers or their health department to see what's being shared right now. Because I know at Children of Wisconsin, our primary care sites are putting together messages to our patients. We'll be sending messages out to our patients in anticipation of this once we have a better idea about when we'll be able to give the vaccine, as you said, get shots in arms. And we want to make sure at Children's Wisconsin, we're notifying our patients and those who would be interested in getting the vaccine as soon as possible.
Those sound like great places for parents to go to if they've got more questions. So thanks for flagging that. As we wait for the official approval, you know, there's also another population of kiddos that my son Ethan falls into, which is kids under 5. What can you tell us about vaccines for the youngest children? What advice do you have for parents on how to keep them safe?
Yeah, and Dr. Ehrenfeld, I think this is probably a personal question for you, as you have a younger child. And I would say that so right now, for younger children, as much as possible, follow those precautionary measures, the layers of protection that we talked about. And in the meantime, there is data being gathered. There are field studies being done right now to gather information, much like has been done over the past year for the various authorizations and approvals for the vaccine. And we'll see when that data becomes available. I don't have a crystal ball that works very well right now about that one, but we're hoping perhaps by the end of the year or maybe into next year, first quarter, we'll start to get that data and then determine if that would be, if even more kiddos could get shots in arms.
Great. So for school age children all across the board, what are the current health and safety guidelines that you recommend people follow?
I think the continued use of the strategies that have worked are the most important thing. I tend to look to trusted resources when there are questions about how to best prevent the spread. Places like the CDC, the Wisconsin Department of Health Services, the American Academy of Pediatrics, local health departments, your primary care provider. But those strategies that we talked about earlier work very well and very effectively. And we have a graphic, if I could just pull it up and maybe just remind people. We'll pull up graphic number one just to show people as a reminder.
It's helpful because sometimes the simple things are really all we can do, but they make such a difference when you layer on washing your hands, just staying home if you're not feeling well, not going out. I imagine getting a flu shot is also probably an important recommendation. Other things that come to mind or are on the graphic?
Absolutely. I'll reinforce what you said. I keep hand hygiene handy. I keep my mask handy. I make sure that I'm at least 6 feet away from people. And another thing that is important is making sure that we work or go to school when we're well. So if one is symptomatic, one should not be in an environment where they're close to other people because of the risk of spread, not only of COVID, but the other thing that we're seeing right now, Dr. Ehrenfeld, is in the state of Wisconsin, a high degree of unusually early respiratory viruses in kids. Things like respiratory syncytial virus or RSV and some other typical viruses that are much earlier in the year than we would typically see them, causing a lot more illness and a lot more severity of illness in kids. So it's not just COVID that we're seeing right now in kids. We're seeing a lot of other respiratory viruses too. And I'm not sure if we can get the graphic up, and if we can't, that's okay. One other thing I did want to back up to just to make sure I'm very clear with people, is that the dose of vaccine that is recommended for the just approved 5 to 11 year old group is that it would be, it's a smaller dose than what adults are receiving, okay? So in the adult dose is about three times the dose that the kids in the 6 to 11 year old group range would be receiving.
Got it. That's helpful. So why don't we go ahead and turn to some questions from the audience? We've got lots that are starting to come in. One I think we've already covered, which is when do we think we're going to start to get Anything from two and up, and again, sounds like maybe first part of next year is when that'll start to come in. And again, I'll just remind viewers in the audience, go ahead and put things into the chat, and we'll go ahead and try to get to as many of these as we can. Next question, we've been hearing questions about the ingredients in the vaccines. Is there stuff in there that parents should be worried about that maybe is different from other vaccines? These are different vaccines, they're newer vaccines. Comments about what's in there?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I really appreciate it, because there is a lot of confusion and even some misinformation about what is in the vaccine. One can go to the CDC website and actually find out what the actual ingredients are in the vaccine. You can just look at the CDC website and it gives the list of ingredients. So for the most part, the ingredients that are in the vaccine are only those necessary to have the vaccine be effective, and also to preserve the vaccine long enough so it doesn't become less effective when it's in the vial before it's administered. And actually, compared to some of the earlier vaccines, there are less ingredients in the current vaccines that are available for COVID than in some of the previous vaccines. As usual, one should be aware that if one has an allergy to any of the ingredients in the vaccine, then one should be cautious about receiving the vaccine. But it's very rare that would be the case.
Okay. And, we mentioned the importance of getting flu shots. We're starting to see a lot of respiratory illnesses across the state, particularly in kids. Recommendations, can you get the flu shot and a COVID shot at the same time? Do you have to wait? What does that look like for kids and adults?
Well, good, very good question. We'll see what the recommendations from the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices is. That's part of the CDC approval process. So we'll wait to see what their recommendation is about the co-administration of vaccines. But I would like to take this opportunity to reinforce what you just said, Dr. Ehrenfeld, and that is that, as a pediatrician, I really believe that the best treatment for anything is prevention whenever possible. So prevention through vaccines and all the other measures that we talked about. And it is really important to get your flu vaccine this year if you can, because we don't know what the flu season will be like. We know that last year there was not much of a flu season, but we can't predict that will be the case this year.
Yeah. Okay. The next question we've got is from a parent concerned about their child who's got a history of reactions to vaccines. And they're curious, should their 12-year-old maybe be getting the dosage for what's approved for 5 to 11-year-old. Is the dosage done by age or by weight? What should that parent maybe talk about with their pediatrician?
Yeah, that is a great question. And thank you for bringing that forward, because I think while we can give some general guidelines about what works for most people, there are individual circumstances that need to be considered when there are concerns about a child's health history or reaction to vaccines in the past. My encouragement would be to talk to your primary care provider, who can then either share information that might be helpful, or talk to an expert themselves to give guidance. And that's what we do at Children's Wisconsin sometimes. We'll get calls from primary care providers who aren't sure about a reaction or want to know a little bit more about whether it's safe to administer. And we all want to do the right thing for kids and make sure that we protect them as much as possible. So if there's a concern, contact your primary care provider, who can reach out to additional resources if necessary.
Would you ever recommend a child get their shot administered in a hospital as opposed to a clinic in a situation where maybe they've had a reaction in the past?
There are very rare circumstances where that might be the desirable approach. I would say that what we've learned from the administration of COVID in the current state is that that's a very, very rare circumstance, and one that should definitely be a conversation between the primary care provider and the specialist who might be doing that.
Great. So the next question I've got is similar to the last one, but if my child is 11 and maybe their birthday is coming up, should I wait for them to get the 12-year-old dose if approval is made for 5 to 11 the next week?
Yeah, very good question. My bias as a primary care provider would be get the vaccine as soon as you can. And I think that would depend on the timing. If the vaccine is available to an 11-year-old soon, then get it as soon as you can. But if your birthday is a couple of weeks out and it doesn't look like that's going to be able to happen, then I would say get it at the first available time that you can.
Makes a lot of sense. Question about commenting on the side effects of any vaccines in kids. What about cardiomyelitis or other reports out there in the world about potential drawbacks to getting the vaccine?
Yeah, let me just talk a little bit about the impact of COVID and then some of the cardiomyopathy, which is an inflammation of the heart, and some other types of side effects from the vaccine itself.
Thank you for telling us what cardiomyopathy is, because I'm sure a lot of viewers hear that word, but they don't really know what it means.
Yeah, so first of all, just in terms of the impact of COVID itself, because I think it's important to understand how COVID can impact individuals and then what the vaccine side effects are, because it's all a risk and benefit ratio. We want to make sure that we're looking at the risks as well as the benefits. So when we think about the impact of COVID on kids, as I said, the burden of COVID has been felt heaviest in adults. However, this is not a benign illness in kids. We know that. We know that kids do get COVID and they can get severe infections from COVID, and that's something that we need to be aware of. One of the side effects of infection, COVID infection, is something called multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children. So this is an inflammation of the internal organs in children. It can cause inflammation of the heart, the kidneys, the brain, the gastrointestinal system, the lungs. It's very important because there have been over 5,000 cases of this reported in the country since it was first described about a year and a half ago. In about 120 cases in the state of Wisconsin. And this is not a benign thing. It can cause some very serious illness. So we want to make sure that we're aware that that's the case. Now, when we talk about the side effects from the COVID vaccines, we do know that there are some side effects. Every vaccine has potential side effects. The most common, by far and away, the most common side effects we see are what we would typically expect from a vaccine. So that would be a swelling at the site of the injection where the vaccine was given, perhaps a little bit of tiredness, maybe a low-grade fever, maybe just a feeling of not feeling so great for the first 24 hours or so. Those are short-lived and full recovery from those occurs. And I'll just share with you, I just had my booster COVID vaccine. I had a little bit of soreness in the arm for a day or so. Otherwise, I felt pretty good. Now, in terms of the other side effects, the concerning side effects, we do know, and this again is a learning opportunity, we learn more with more vaccine given, we learn more about the vaccine. We do know that there are some side effects that we want to watch for very carefully. Inflammation of the heart is the one, and the fluid around the heart are the two that have been studied and looked at and have been are carefully and thoughtfully being considered for this risk and benefit. And what we know is that there are some who do get an inflammation from that. What we know is that it tends to be in younger males, so teenage or early adult males have a higher preponderance of this. But when we take that into account, considering the number of doses given, it's a handful of cases for a million doses of vaccines. So it's a very, very small number. I don't want to say it's inconsequential because any side effect is something that we need to watch carefully. Those side effects are usually transient. And they usually recover. There's usually recovery without any long-term effects from what we can tell at this point in time. So we'll continue to watch that.
Thanks for providing that perspective, because I hear all the time from parents that I know that nobody wants their kids to get COVID, but it's not that big a deal. It's like the flu, they'll be fine. And for most kids, that's true. But there are kids, 120 Wisconsin, who got really, really sick from COVID, and so the risk of getting sick is out there, and anything we can do to prevent it, like getting vaccines, is helpful.
Dr. Arnfeld, could I just add one quick thing there? I think that was a great point. The other thing that I just want to make sure that we understand is that we get vaccinated for ourselves, but also for the greater public health. And so we know that kids can spread COVID. So although they might not get as sick, they certainly can spread COVID to relatives and loved ones within their family, within their circle of contacts. And we know that that can drive infection rates up. So I want to make sure that we advocate on behalf of public health as well as our own personal health.
That's great. It's not just about protecting the individual who's getting the shot, but it also helps grandma and everybody else in the community. So that makes a lot of sense. The next question I want to get to is, if a child has had COVID, how long after they've recovered can they get a COVID vaccine?
Another great question. And what I would recommend is let's see what the advisory committee recommends for that, because there that has been a shifting, the answer to that has shifted a little bit as we get more and more information available. So there'll be more information forthcoming about that in terms of the recommendations following a COVID infection.
That's great. So we've got a couple of questions that are all kind of on the same theme. What do you say to people who are concerned that these vaccines were developed too quickly, might not be safe, or there are other consequences we might not know about yet?
Yeah, I would say thank you for asking the question, because it's important for us to understand what the process was and what the timeline was. And I would say that the vaccines it's remarkable that these vaccines were developed in the timeframe that they were. And I don't mean remarkable in the sense of stunning. I mean remarkable in the sense of a medical breakthrough that is significant. The technology that these vaccines are based on is not new. This technology has been around for a number of years. It was first put into a large-scale production with COVID vaccine. And the other thing that I would say is that I think that's a very real concern that people had initially. But as millions and millions and now a billion doses of vaccine are being given across the world, we have more and more information about the safety and the effectiveness of the vaccine. And again, I want to stress that that is a very good question. We continue to gather data on it. But, you know, COVID infections have taken the lives of over 750,000 Americans. And that is a stunning number. And so whatever we can do to stop the spread of this infection and to help us all get back to doing the things that we love to do is important. And we want to weigh the risks and the benefits of that. You know, I would say all of us want to get rid of masks. Nobody wants to wear masks anymore. We're tired of that. And the way to do that is by doing all the mitigation strategies, the layers of protection that we talked about.
That's great. The next question is, different side effect profiles for different vaccines. Is there a difference in the myocarditis, heart inflammation that we're seeing Pfizer versus Moderna? What do we know about the different brands and what's available?
Yeah, so there are some differences. We know that the messenger RNA, mRNA vaccines, which are Pfizer and Moderna, do have a higher likelihood of having that the inflammation of the heart and the fluid around the heart. And we know that the Johnson & Johnson vaccine does have a higher incidence of certain types of blood clots. So we know that those are two side effects that we want to watch very, very carefully. What I would say, again, I want to stress that the risk of these side effects is very, very rare. It's not zero. I want to be honest and candid. It's not zero. But when we weigh the risks and benefits, and that's what the FDA panels and the Centers for Disease Control panels are doing, is the risk, is the benefit much, much greater than the risk? And that's what the panel approved yesterday, is that they felt that the risk was much less than the benefit gained.
So we've got a couple more questions. We're running a little short on time, but I want to try to get to as many as we can. So maybe we can just cover these things briefly. Concerns about impact on the vaccines related to adult fertility. There's been some news items on that. What can you say? Any concerns that parents should be worried about?
I look to the expert organizations to make comments about that. So there's an organization called the American College of Gynecology, and the Maternal Fetal Medicine Societies, both of whom are trusted and valued resources. Both of those organizations recommend vaccines for those who are considering getting pregnant, are pregnant, or are breastfeeding. And it's a strong recommendation from them.
That's helpful. The last question I think we're going to have time for before we wrap is, if my child had Guillain-Barré syndrome as a one-year-old, should they get the vaccine?
Yeah. What I would do is talk to your provider about that. There is some information coming out about Guillain-Barré, which is an effect that causes some muscle paralysis or muscle weakness. And so I would definitely talk to your provider about that and make sure that you have a conversation about that appropriateness.
Perfect. And could you just reiterate again before we close, there are a couple of places you mentioned to go get resources, some websites, other things. Where should people turn if they're looking for more information, particularly as these approvals come out hopefully in the next week or so?
Yeah, great, Dr. Ehrenfeld. Thanks for reinforcing that. We want to make sure that the people get the information from trustworthy resources. There's a lot of information out there. What I would say is focus on your primary care provider, your local health department, the Department of Health Services of Wisconsin, the American Academy of Pediatrics, and the Centers for Disease Control. Those all are very good resources to start with and will provide you with information that's helpful.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Well, I just want to thank you, Dr. Goodsight, for joining us today. And to our viewers, if there's a topic you're interested in hearing more about in a future episode, let us know. Drop us an email, conversations@mcw.edu. Again, conversations@mcw.edu. And we'll consider it for a future episode. Again, I'm Dr. Jesse Ehrenfeld, and I hope you'll join us next month for a virtual coffee break and a conversation on science.